Yes, thanks to the organizers as well for inviting me. I really appreciate this invitation to one of my favorite subject of research, petri nets. And so today, yes, I'm going to present some results, recent and old results as well, about petri nets and more precisely about flat petri nets. So we will see later what does it mean, flat. And in fact, this talk is related to the reachability problem for petri nets and, I mean, the related problems and the Presburger arithmetic. Okay, so the Presburger arithmetic is the first order logic over the natural numbers. It's a decidable logic. We can describe linear constraints on variables of natural number of variables. And there is a link between the reachability problem on one side and the Presburger arithmetic. And I will try to give you some results explaining the connections between those two objects. Okay, so in this talk, so I'm going to talk about something about petri nets, and we all know that petri nets, it's a good model because there is a lot of applications of petri nets, and there is also nice results, theoretical results about petri nets. Yes, Fabrice, you have a question maybe? No? Mm-hmm. Okay. And but in this talk, I'm going to focus not on petri nets, but on the equivalent model. It's the model of vector addition systems with states. And this model is equivalent for many problems. And I prefer to give my talk about that model rather than petri nets, just because it's easier to provide some examples using some data structure, using some structure, control structure. It means that we can enforce, compared to a petri net, we can enforce some transition to be executed with respect to a regular language, for instance. So more formally, a vector addition system is just a finite state automaton. So we have a finite set of states, Q, and we have transitions between states. So it's a directed graph, such that transitions are labeled by vector of integers. Compared to a petri net, it's those vectors somehow correspond to the effect of executing the transition of a petri net. So it means that if we look at an example, it means that we have intuitively, we have some counters or some places of a petri net, and we can update places by adding the effect of a transition. So for instance, if you look at this example, this is a vector addition system in dimension two. So we have two counters, and those two counters are modified by the transition, by executing transitions. For instance, if you look at this transition on P, this is a loop, and this transition will remove one on the first counter and add one on the second one. Well, so it's a loop. That intuitively, if you iterate that loop, you are going to transfer one by one the value of the first place or the first counter to the second place. The other loop on Q is doing something similar, except that we add two. Okay, so we can remove one on the first counter and add two, remove one on the second one and add two on the second, on the first counter. And those two transitions are not labeled. Intuitively, they are labeled by the zero vector, meaning that the counter are untouched if you go from P to Q. We will come back to the semantics in the next slide. This is just an example of the syntax of a vector addition system, and I provided an example. And as you can see in this case, the dimension, it's what we call the dimension of the vector addition system is the number of counters. It is two in that case. We have two control states and we have four transitions. The semantics is defined as expected. The configuration is just a pair given as a place, in which place, in which control state we are, and what is the value of the counter. So the counter, like for petri nets, evolves in the natural numbers. So it means that a counter cannot be negative. So it means that at some point, maybe a transition can be blocked. For instance, a transition that decrement a counter is blocked if the counter, the corresponding counter is zero. Okay, so here it is the semantics. It is defined the expected way. And we can extend as soon as we have defined the semantics. As usual, we can define the effect not just of one transition, but of a world of transitions. It corresponds to execute the transition one by one. And we can also introduce the reachability relation between configuration that corresponds to the fact that there exists a sequence of steps that move from a configuration PX to a configuration Q1. There is one important object when we are interested in some problems related to vector addition system with states is the computation of, is it possible to compute the reachability set? So it means that if you provide an initial set of configurations, C, so given by just maybe one configuration or by a constraint over the different counters. So you provide just a set of configuration. And the question is it possible to describe, to compute somehow, a representation of the reachability set? Meaning all the configurations that you can reach, starting from a configuration in C, the configuration you can reach from C, and you look at this set. This is the reachability set. Let us have a look on, let us come back to the first example I provided in this presentation. You remember this example is a vector addition system with two loops. One loop that intuitively transfers the content of the first counter to the second one, and another loop on Q that transfers the content of the second counter to the first one. Let's try to compute the reachability set of this vector addition system starting from the state P and 1, 0. So we start from the first counter is 1 and the second counter is 0. If you execute from this configuration, if you execute T1 and then T2, then T3, then T4, you can obtain such an execution. And you can see that the configuration we obtain is larger than the first one. Okay, so P1, 0. From P1, 0, we just add 1 on the first counter and get P2, 0. And like for Petrinets, vector addition system is a monotonic system in the sense that if a sequence of steps provide you a larger configuration, then you can iterate this sequence of steps an arbitrary number of times. And at every time, at every execution of this sequence, you will increment your counter by the same value. Okay, so it means that you can encode with a variable, an integer variable, you can encode the effect of iterating this sequence, meaning that if you start from P1, 0, and you execute T1, T2, T3, T4, you execute this sequence n-1 times, you are going to produce a configuration of that form, P and n, which is the n I selected, and 0. Okay, so it means that all the configuration of the form P, n, 0, are reachable for this vector addition system. And now by using the transition T1, which transfers the content of the first counter to the second one, if I execute this T1 some number of times, I will have a way, a kind of witness of the reachability set. Okay, let's have a look. You see, if you execute T1, T2, T3, T4, let's say n plus m times minus one, okay, and then T1 m times, I will get a configuration of that form, P and m. And if I execute T2, I will get Q and m. And in fact, this example shows this is a kind of way we can use in order to compute the reachability set. In fact, in that case, this example show, I mean, this kind of computation shows that the reachability set is exactly that set, the set of all configuration except 0, 0, the configuration where the two counters are 0 simultaneously. Okay. So as you can see, using iteration of sequence of transitions, on that example, we find a way to compute the reachability set of this example. The natural question is it possible to extend this technique to arbitrary system in order to compute the reachability set? So the answer is no in general, but in practice, on some example, it works quite well, this technique, and it's what we call the acceleration technique. And we have implemented, maybe 20 years ago, we implemented a tool, the FAST tool. It's a symbolic model checker, which computes the reachability set of systems manipulating counters by computing step by step the effect of iterating sequence of transitions. Okay, so this idea of computing the reachability set of a system manipulating counters, it's what we call acceleration techniques. Natural question now, which is related to the title of my talk, is in which case this technique is terminating? In fact, this question is natural because there exist some examples such that the acceleration techniques fail. For instance, the Hopcroft and Ponsieu example shows that such an example. So intuitively, if you think about acceleration techniques, we are going to introduce variables encoding the number of times we iterate some sequence of transitions. And intuitively, we are going to compute a formula, the Pressburger formula, encoding the reachability set. And this formula will be a formula such that the three variables that occurs in this formula correspond to the number of times we iterate the first loop, the number of times we iterate the second loops, and so on. So when the acceleration technique terminates, we are sure that the reachability set is definable in the Pressburger arithmetic. But this example is a counter example. Intuitively, it shows that there exists a vector addition system such that reachability set is not definable in the Pressburger arithmetic. If you look at this example, it's exactly the same as the previous one, except that now the dimension is three. And the third component, as you can see, is untouched on the two cycles. Okay, I put zero, but I put a one in order to come back from Q to P. Okay, so it means that if I want to iterate the transfer from the first counter to the second one, and then the transfer and the multiplication by two from the second counter to the first one, every time I would like to iterate such behavior, I need to pay something. I need to increment the third counter. So intuitively, this third counter will count the number of times we are going to multiply by two, the two first counters. And you can prove, okay, by hand, with a hand written proof, you can prove that the reachability set starting from P1, 0, 0 is exactly this set. And as you can see, you have a constraint that is non-linear. It's a constraint of the form X1 plus X2 is bounded by a power, two power variable. And such a constraint is not a linear constraint, and so it's not definable in the Pressburger arithmetic. So this example is an example that shows that the reachability set cannot be computed using acceleration techniques. But, okay, so the question of identifying which vector addition system admits a computation of the reachability set with acceleration techniques is a natural question because there exist some examples such that it's not the case. And in fact, this question is related to the flat vector addition systems. So a vector addition system is said to be flat if, when you look at the control structure, every state admits just one simple cycle. Okay, so for instance, on the left, this example, this is a flat VAS, okay? Because if you look at any state, you have just one simple cycle on that state. Okay? But the VAS on the right is not a flat VAS. If you look at the central state, this one, you have two simple cycles, this one and this one, and they are different. So this one is not flat. Intuitively, it means that there is no nested cycles in the control structure. Okay, so this idea of looking at the data structure, the control structure of an automaton and try to deduce some properties about the fact that this control structure is flat or not, is related to some density of words accepted by this automaton. Okay, you can have some, this is a reference of some properties about flat automata. But in our context, what's important is the fact that the reachability set of a flat VAS is always definable in the Presburger arithmetic. In fact, intuitively, since you have just one simple cycle on every state, you can associate, if you have an execution of your vector addition system, you can associate to every simple cycle the number of times you execute this simple cycle during the execution of the path. And then you can encode, you can in fact compile, this is the title of this paper, you can compile the reachability set as a Presburger formula that encodes not only the reachability set, but in fact the reachability relation of your system. Okay, so if we sum up this paper, we can say that the reachability set from a Presburger set C of configuration is Presburger as soon as the VAS is flat. So this is a sufficient condition to be computable by acceleration techniques. But in fact, there exist some systems that are not flat and such that the reachability set is computable using acceleration. And it's related to the notion not of flat VAS, but of flattable VAS. So this is intuitively the notion of flattable VAS is the fact that assume that you have a vector addition system, this one like on the right. Okay, we have this vector addition system, it's not flat. Okay, we have two simple cycles on that state. Okay, those two simple cycles. And we would like to compute the reachability set of this vector addition system. What we are going to do is to use a kind of unfolding of your vector addition system in such a way the unfolding will be flat. Okay, like this one, you see, this one on the left is a kind of partial unfolding. When I say unfolding, I mean that if you look at this vector addition system, you have a function f that maps every state of this VAS, V prime, to states of V. And in such a way, if you have a transition like this one, A1, if you apply F on the source and the target of this transition, you will get a transition on the original VAS from the image of the source to the image of the target. This is what we call the flattening. And this is an important notion in order to compute reachability set. In fact, if you want to compute the reachability set of V starting from a set C, what we can do is we can push back from the configuration C of V, we can push back those configurations to the configuration of V prime. Okay. In such a way that we get a set that we denoted by F minus one of C. So we get a set of configuration on that VAS, which is flat. So we can compute the reachability set of that VAS starting from that set, and we get the Pressburger formula, and we can push, and we can put back the reachability set we obtain on V prime to V. Okay, and what we can see, it's not difficult, is that we always obtain an under approximation of the reachability set. Okay, it means that the reachability set we would like to compute always contains this under approximation. I mean, the computation we obtain using an unfolding, a partial unfolding of your vector addition system. When the partial, when the inclusion is an equality, it's a good point because it means that we obtain the way to compute the reachability set. And in that case, we said that the flattening is complete for the initial set of configuration. In that paper, we prove that, in fact, it's an if and only if condition to be flattable in order to be computable using Pressburger arithmetic. In that paper, in fact, we prove that the reachability set of a vector addition system starting from a Pressburger set is Pressburger if and only if there exists a complete flattening starting from C. So it means that the acceleration techniques we developed 20 years ago in order to compute the reachability set of systems, some Minsky machines, so it's like it's Petri nets with inhibitor arcs. This technique that was, some heuristic techniques, in fact, are complete as soon as you want to compute the reachability set of a vector addition system, as soon as the reachability set is definable in the Pressburger arithmetic. So naturally, the main question is how to detect cycles that we'd like to accelerate, but you need some heuristics and it's a different problem. But at least the method is complete for computing the reachability set as soon as it's definable in the Pressburger arithmetic. When the reachability set is not definable in the Pressburger arithmetic, like the Hopcroft-Ponsio example I provided just before. The reachability problem is still decidable, but in fact, there is no trivial way of computing the reachability set in that case. Naturally, the reachability problem is not a problem of computing a reachability set. The reachability problem is a decision problem. The question is, I provide you two configurations. Does there exist an execution from the initial one to the final one? It's not the computation of the reachability set. Naturally, if we can compute the reachability set, we can decide this question, but it's not exactly the same problem. So this problem is important because many other problems reduce or are equivalent to the reachability problem. I provided some examples, some field where you can find problems that are equivalent to the reachability problems. So this problem, the reachability problem, is a central problem, but it's a difficult one. Just to remember, to recall the state of the art and the history of that problem. So the reachability problem was first proved to be X-space hard by Lipton in 1976. Few years later, it was proved to be decidable by Mayer, and the proof was simplified by Kozarajou and by Lambert. And in fact, it corresponds to the fact that the problem is decidable. It's because we have an algorithm that decides the reachability problem. This algorithm, we call it the KLM algorithm with respect to the name of the authors. And in fact, there is also another algorithm. There is this KLM algorithm and another one, a very simple algorithm based on the Pressburger arithmetic, that is given in two papers, I mean several papers between 2009 and 2012. So this algorithm is based on the following fact. If a configuration is reachable, then there exists, you can provide a witness of that property, which corresponds to a sequence of transitions that explain why your configuration is reachable. Okay, so the reachability problem is a recursively countable problem. So the question is, what is a witness of non-reachability? Does there exist, if you want to prove that a configuration is not reachable, do you have a witness that can be checked effectively in order to prove that the configuration is not reachable? So the answer is yes, there exists simple witness. In fact, if a configuration is not reachable, there always exists an inductive invariant that is definable in the Presburger arithmetic. Okay, so that means if you want to prove that a configuration is not reachable, there always exists a kind of a conjunction of constraints, conjunction or disjunction of linear constraints over your variables that explain why your configuration is not reachable. So it means that the problem is recursively countable and the dual problem is also recursively countable. So the problem is decidable. Okay, so the reachability problem can be decided with two semi-algorithms that are executed in parallel that fairly enumerate paths and executions of your system and fairly enumerate Presburger formula. And since you can decide if a formula is an inductive invariant, then you can decide the reachability problem with such an algorithm. So I provided an interval of time because in 2009, this proof was based on the KLM algorithm. And in 2012, it was a direct proof. It's a non-constructive proof, but a short one, a short proof explaining why there always exists inductive invariants in the Presburger arithmetic. With colleagues, I also worked on the complexity of the problem, and we recently managed to solve the problem. So concerning the complexity upper bound with Sylvain Schmitz, we proved in 2015, we proved that the reachability problem, I mean the KLM algorithm, we proved that this algorithm is, the complexity is exotic. It's cubic Karmanian, so I will not enter in the detail of this complexity class. And a few years later, we find a way to simplify the algorithm, the KLM algorithm, and we find a new ranking function for the termination of that algorithm, and we manage to prove that the reachability problem is at most Ackermannian. So it's a non-primitive recursive complexity upper bound, but it's still a complexity bound. And with some other colleagues, we prove in 2019, we prove that in fact, the X-space lower bound that stay the best complexity lower bound for more than 40 years, in fact, it's not the right complexity bound. In fact, we can prove that in that paper, we prove in a paper with my colleagues here, we prove that in fact, the reachability problem is hard for a tower of complexity. So it means that the reachability problem is non-elementary. And very recently, the papers are available on archive. We provided independently two results, two papers about the fact that the tower lower bound can be improved a little bit more to prove that in fact, the reachability problem is Ackermannian complete. Okay, so now, we are sure that the complexity of the reachability problem is Ackermannian. So it's a very high complexity class. But as usual, it's not because a problem is Ackermannian that there is no solution, practical solution. I mean, we all know that the formal verification of systems is undecidable in general, but there is some nice solution to do it in practice. So naturally, this is a theoretical result provided the complexity in the worst case. But in fact, the problem of finding good tools for the reachability problem is still an open question. So concerning FLATVAS, so what is the complexity of the reachability problem for FLATVAS? I mentioned that we can compile the reachability relation of a FLATVAS as a Presburger formula. We can be a little bit more precise. In fact, this formula is an existential formula of the Presburger arithmetic. So it means that in NP, the complexity class NP, we can decide the reachability problem for FLATVAS. A natural question is, is it NP or NP complete? I mean, can we do something better? But the answer is, it depends on the way the vector addition system is encoded. So if your vector addition system is encoded in binary, I mean, the effect of your transition are defined in binary, then the problem is NP complete already in dimension one, just because you can encode this classical subset sum problem. You remember this problem, you have a number encoded in binary, S, and a sequence of numbers, S1, Sk. And the question is, does there exist a subset of S1, Sk, such that the sum of this subset is exactly S? So this problem is NP complete. And so if we have a reduction of that problem as a reachability problem for a FLATVAS, it means that our problem is NP complete. And the reduction is quite simple. If you look at this, this vector addition system is a flat one. In fact, there is no cycle. It's an acyclic vector addition system. We start from the control state Q1 with the counter zero. And at every for every state, we select either we add S1 or we add zero. Either we add S2 or we add zero, and so on. So the reachability problem starting from Q1 zero, is it possible to reach QKS? So the S we want to obtain is exactly an encoding of this subset sum problem. Okay, so it means that in binary, the reachability problem is NP complete. In unary, I mean, if the numbers are encoded in unary, so it means that intuitively you can just increment or decrement your counter. You cannot add 2^100. You can just add or decrement by one. What is the complexity of the reachability problem for FLATVAS? So the problem is not completely solved for the moment. At least in dimension one, when we have just one counter, using some Hill-cutting arguments, you can prove that the problem is log space complete. It's just because it's like a push-down automaton. I mean, when you have just one counter, you can encode it as a stack. Okay, and if you want to prove that you can reach a configuration, a final one from an initial one, if the stack become too high, then you can cut your execution such that the height of the stack will be quadratically bounded. I mean, or cubic bounded, corresponding to the number of control states. So this idea holds also for vector addition system in dimension FLATVAS in dimension one. But in fact, it also holds for FLATVAS in dimension two. In that paper, in fact, it's an interesting paper because it introduces some non-trivial techniques of simplifying execution. In that paper, they prove that also in dimension two, the reachability problem for FLATVAS is log space complete. Okay, they prove in fact that there is always a technique to reduce a long run to obtain a short run. And since we know that vector addition systems in dimension two are flattable, they are always flattable, We can apply, in fact, this technique to prove that not only the reachability problem for flat VAS in dimension 2, but also for the classical vector addition system in dimension 2 is log space complete when numbers are encoded in unary. So I would like to give you an idea why this the technique presented in that paper is not a classical Hill-Curtin argument. So this is the result of the paper, the fact that there exist always short runs between two configurations. And this example, I hope that this example will convince you that the result is not simple. Let's look at this two-dimensional vector addition system. We start with the state P with 0, 0 on the two counter. And the question is it possible to reach the state Q with 0, 0 as well on the two counters? So let's look at this run. We start from this state, we execute that transition, which had one on the first counter, and then we iterate this loop. And this loop intuitively decrement the first counter and multiply by two and push this counter to the second one. Okay. So I mean, starting from 1, 0, I will get 0, 2. And then on this loop, I will multiply by 2 again. So I will get 2 power 2, 0, and so on. Okay, so in that state, I will get 2 power n on the first counter and 0 on the second one. And the other loops on the bottom are doing something symmetrical. Intuitively, when we iterate those loops, we divide by 2 the counter. Okay, so we divide by 2, and then we remove the value 1, 0 that we first added in this execution. So if you think about this run, it's an exponentially long run because we reach exponentially large counters, and all the configuration we obtain along that run are incomparable. Okay, because every time, okay, we start from 0. 2 power n, and we are going to decrement the other counter in order to obtain 0, 2 power n plus 1. Okay, so this way of moving the counters makes the configuration incomparable along the execution. So there is no Hill-Curtin argument, no, at least not trivial Hill-Curtin argument on this example. But they managed to obtain a way to reduce runs. In this example, there exists a simple run. I mean, you start from P with 0, 0, you execute that transition, and we just execute the transition without executing the cycles, and we get a short run. But in order to extend this idea to any system, we need something, a strong idea to obtain this result. Okay, so to sum up, to provide some results, I would like just to mention that the Presburger arithmetic is central to decide the reachability questions for vector addition systems. It's related to, it's used to decide the reachability problem, but also to obtain some fine grain complexity bound in small dimensions. There is some open problems. I mentioned that the reachability problem is closed, but not completely. I mean, if you fix the dimension, there is still a gap of complexity between the lower bound and the upper bound. So this problem is still open, the complexity, the parametric complexity of the reachability problem. There is also some problem about unary flat VAS. I mentioned that in dimension 2, the problem is log space complete. We know that in dimension 5, this is another paper, in dimension 5, the problem is NP complete. But in between, in dimension 3 and in dimension 4, the statue of the complexity of the problem is still open. And we think with my colleagues, we think that it's an important problem in order to, for instance, to understand how to encode complex computation with a small number of counters. And we hope that if we find a way to solve those problems, we will find a way to solve the complexity of the fixed dimension, parameterized fixed dimension reachability problem. I mentioned that if the reachability set is Presburger, then it is flattable. It's an if and only if. The question, it means that we have a weakness. When we want to prove that a reachability set is Presburger, a weakness is a scheme of acceleration somehow. But what is a weakness of non-Presburger defined when it's not definable in the Presburger arithmetic? So we have no idea of what should be the form of a weakness which explains why the reachability set, like for the Hopcroft and Ponsieux example, we don't know what is the form of such a certificate. And last but not least, I think that even if the reachability problem is Ackermannian complete, I think it's important to develop good tools to decide the reachability problem in practice. I mean, some complete method. I would like to have a tool that can decide the reachability problem for any class of Petri nets or vector addition system, but in such a way, in practice, on a lot of examples, it works well in the sense that it finds a short proof that something is unreachable, for instance, a formula in the Presburger arithmetic, or a short run proving that the configuration is reachable. So thanks for your attention, and thanks again for the invitation. It was a great pleasure.